is, after all, an important issue which affects you and should affect you, and should be of concern to you. It's some years now that people like West Streeting have stuck their heads in the sand, have attacked the messengers instead of criticised the message, and gone on doing so with apparently no apologies for the times you get it wrong again and again. I think this is an important issue, and I think it is serious, just as serious as the quote that was read out to you earlier, or I said in the Wall Street Journal just a few days ago. It's serious that this university and others in London and elsewhere breed hatred because they do. In 2002, Omar Sheikh kidnapped and beheaded the Wall Street Journal reporter Daniel Pearl in Pakistan. He was radicalized whilst at the London School of Economics. In 2003, it was two young... I've got to make some of it. In 2003, it was two undergraduates from King's College in London who went out to Tel Aviv to murder as many Israelis as they could in a suicide bombing operation in Mike's Bar. After 7/7, I might have thought things would change, but no. The airline bombing in the summer of 2006 was spearheaded by the head of a London-based Islamic society. In 2008, the think tank which I run commissioned the respected polling company YouGov to do a poll of Muslim and non-Muslim attitudes on campuses. It's still the only substantial poll done on that subject. YouGov do not lie, Wes. They are a polling company. And the things they found were indeed upsetting. They were upsetting because they found radical attitudes. Nobody wanted to find them, but that was the attitudes that were found. They found, among other things, that up to a third of, just under a third of Muslim students believed that killing in the name of their religion was justified. And that doubled among students who were members of Islamic societies. This wasn't just found in a poll by YouGov. It was something which you can hear. I can hear. Anyone with ears can hear. Muslim students telling, which is that very often ordinary Muslim students come to universities like this one and discover that instead of finding a good religious society like every other society, which they have a right to, a decent Muslim student society, they find a political society, a radical political society, such as the one that was run here by Abdul Muttalib, who invited hate speakers. You may joke, Wes, that there was nobody nastier than George Galloway. That was at the week, the War on Terror week. You so glibly just laughed away. I would suggest that Yvonne Ridley, for instance, who believed that Abu Muzaffar al-Zarqawi, the most brutal head hacker of Iraq in 2004, that's not a nice person to have on campus. So why do you find it funny? Why do you find it funny that such people are allowed to turn up and speak on this, as long as they're speaking Islamic society? I want you to take 2 points home with you tonight. I don't suspect my side is likely to win your support, because this is your campus and you're going to feel pride in it and you're going to feel defensive about it, and you have every right to. But please take the following 2 points with you today. Would it be acceptable, do you think, for any other society on campus, say the Christian Society or the Conservative Society, to invite speakers to talk that people with, say, darker coloured skin than theirs should be killed? No. You wouldn't support that, nor would I. So why do you allow it with Muslim students? Why do you allow a lower expectation to thrive on campus from Muslim societies? If a conservative society organised somebody once, they would be told off. They would be censored in some way. Well, if it happened repeatedly, no, you're crazy, I've seen you here before. Non-Muslim students were well represented by the BNP every time. Represented by the BNP on campus, every time you had a non-Muslim speaker, it would be somebody from the BNP. Would that be nice on your opinion? It wouldn't be on mine. An unopposed BNP speaker every time? You'd start to think there was a problem. Ladies and gentlemen, there is a problem here, because that is exactly what ISOCs like the one at this university have been doing. It is repugnant to me, and it should be repugnant to you. But just 4 weeks before the Detroit bomber tried to murder hundreds of people,
You were meant to have on this campus Abu Uzama coming again. Again, for the second time this year. This is a man who teaches, ladies and gentlemen, that women are mentally deficient even if they have PhDs. Mentally deficient. He teaches when and where to do violent jihad. He teaches that those of us who are gay, like myself and Wes, should be killed. Not in a future caliphate, but now. I don't know why somebody like Wes is so suicidal that he thinks that somebody who incites murder against those of us who are gay is a good thing. I don't know how you hold it. I wish you well with it. And finally, that people who are apostates from Islam should also be killed. I don't know. I genuinely don't know, ladies and gentlemen, why you think that is normal to teach as an ISOC when it should be something which they are criticised for, like any other students. I have to wind up, but just to point the following out to you, if I may. This debate has already been ducked once again by your president, Malcolm Grant, who, after very many serious questions were raised about the campus, which he has a duty of care over, he ducked it by saying that the critics of his institution were, quote, Islamophobic. We're speaking to it again just now, and anyone who wants to speak to any of my Muslim friends or colleagues can see how right his claim is that I don't differentiate between extremists and any other Muslim. But I would just want to point out the following to you, that it would strike me that there are no laws which need to be passed to deal with this problem. We already have, nationally and on this campus, laws against the incitement to murder, against the incitement that occurs at ISOCs like the one on this campus every week. There are already such laws. All you have to do is hold the Muslim societies to the same account you would anyone else. There are already rules, and I've got them all printed out for you if you want to hear them here, Professor Sands, about what you and your colleagues are meant to do in terms of exercising a duty of care. You have abandoned that completely. I would simply finish, ladies and gentlemen, by saying the following. Some years ago, just before the 7/7 bombings, I was speaking at the LSE, the London School of Extremists, and was... better than the Soviets, the School of Organized Anti-Semitism. One of the students said, would you admit, Mr. Murray, on the way out of here tonight, you're far more likely to get run over by a car than you are to be killed in a terrorist atrocity? And I had more sleep, but I finished like sharp on my feet. And I made the following point, which I reiterate to you here tonight. If I walked out of here tonight and was killed by a driver of a car, apart from feeling rather sorry, I would at least want to know if that driver came from a driving school that taught people to run people over, whether he came from a background that taught that such behaviour was good, that you should motivate pedestrians. That is what has been taught on this university campus on the watch of Grant and others. I know you're going to be defensive tonight about your university. You have every right to be, but you have no right to ignore this serious. Thank you.